you pick up an instrument and it has a song inside of it.
I just see a dude alone in his bedroom, yeah, just like jumping around. My.
If there was this sort of retreat from defeat into solitude, and then you record this, like,
right,
that must have felt amazing.
This feels like battle.
Yeah.
To me.
Yeah.
It feels like war. Right.
One of the first things that struck me is how insane of a singer he is.
It's the best instrument I've ever been on stage with. So you have your preconception of what the band is, right?
Yeah.
This folky thing, yeah, and then that happens. Musicians
react. Welcome back to Professional Musicians React.
First, just wanted to say a huge thank you and shout out to the whole community for watching, listening, commenting. Really appreciate you giving us advice on what to listen to next. Thanks for being here.
We are listening to two songs by Bon Iver today with a member of the band, CJ Camerieri. CJ, you've played with Rufus Wainwright, Sufjan Stevens, Bon Iver, Paul Simon, Sting, Yola Tango. The list goes on and on. He's won 2 Grammys. He's a founding member of the contemporary classical ensemble Y Music, whose records I also love.
We're also joined by Tim Sonnenfeld, Grammy-winning engineer, multi-instrumentalist, producer. Tim, thank you so much for engineering.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, what's a memorable song that got you through a hard time?
I'll give you an album that got me through a hard time. Elliott Smith, XOXO.
Yes.
That is the kind of record...
XO.
XO, sorry. Oh, is it just one XO?
One XO.
You're right, it is just XO. When you're in a mood,
yeah,
that record gets you through.
That's one of my favorite records of all time.
Yeah. First the mic, then a half cigarette.
Seeing Kathy's clown. CJ, what do you got?
You know what song I think about is, it's a Paul Simon song, Cool Cool River.
Yeah.
There's like a great line at the end of the song. It says, sometimes even music will not substitute for tears. Sometimes even music cannot substitute for tears. Yeah. Which is like what you're listening to that song for that like reason, if you're like having a hard time, right? Then he says that and you're like, ah, shit. Like, and that was always like really moving for me. That was like a late night, like, Bon Iver tour bus jam. Like, we, yeah, put that on and like a whole bunch of like Midwestern dudes with beards would cry, you know? And it was like a really like, always a moving thing.
There's
and
no, then I can smell the bus. Smell,
yeah. And then like I got a job playing with Paul, and that's, yeah, like the big, one of the big like showcase songs we do. And I would always get like emotional during,
yeah,
that part. And I feel like that's like when the big horn hits are happening. And so I'd have to be like, no, I don't care. I'm not paying attention. I just have to like do my job through that thing. So all these like memories of like, you know, feeling emotions
it's
for that.
It's so powerful when, yeah, music gets attached to a specific time.
Yeah.
It really can bring you back.
What do you got, Ryan? What's a
mine
what's
is
an album?
Fleet Fox's Mykonos. The door slammed loud and rose up a cloud of dust on us. For whatever reason, I was like having like a lot of anxiety or something, or having trouble going to sleep. And I remember putting that song on, and it just like calmed me down, and it worked. And now that's become like my go-to can't sleep, calm down song.
So before we jump into Skinny Love by Bon Iver, you've won a Grammy.
Two
Grammys.
Mm-hmm. With Bon Iver.
So can you explain to me, what is Bon Iver?
Bon Iver is the vision of Justin Vernon, and there's like a core band that it's his vision, but he just brings everybody into this community and says like, do what you do, you know, and we'll find a place for it. And it's really unbelievable how it all comes together.
And so the Cabin in the Woods thing, the first Bon Iver record.
Right.
Solve, what's the real story behind that?
He was a guy that like was always in bands with, yeah, friends, and I think he like stopped playing in one band and like had all these songs inside of him and,
yeah,
made a record and
by himself in the woods.
By himself, I don't know if it was in the woods. Everybody has a cabin. Everybody from the Midwest has a cabin. You know.
Tim, can you tell us about this record before we listen?
Skinny Love was the first single released from Bon Iver's 2007 debut album For Emma Forever Ago. It's about the time that Justin Vernon was in a relationship with his former girlfriend, Christy Smith. He said in an interview, it's about that time in a relationship that I was going through. You're in a relationship because you need help, but that's not necessarily why you should be in a relationship. And that's skinny. And Justin Vernon did everything. He recorded it. He played acoustic guitar. He sang. Nick Peterson engineered it, or mastering engineered it, mastered it.
Here it is, Skinny Love, Bon Iver.
Come on, skinny love, just let's sing it. To pour a little salt we will never eat. My, 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 my. Staring at the sink of love across the needle.
What a song.
What a great song.
It's such a good record. It's such a good...
What a recording.
Yeah.
It's a fascinating recording. Like, thinking about it in the context of, like what do I react to right away, like, from a technical standpoint, is, like, the way he layers his voice, right? Yeah. So, like, normally when you layer a voice, you have, like, the main take, and then you, like, double and triple it, but you try to, like, fit inside of it, you know? And this is almost as if he did, like... however many takes there are, and there are three or four or five takes, yeah. But he did them all like without listening to the other one, right? Yeah. There are like five solo takes put on top of each other. Like he holds certain notes out way longer than other ones, and it's messy, but each one of those voices is like so emotionally like in the moment of the song. Really
interesting. You feel it hard.
You feel it.
There's so much emotion and complex emotion in this. There's like the pleading and the yearning and the solitude. This sounds simple, but every element of it is done in a way that you wouldn't normally do. Okay, the chords are simple chords. They're diatonic, right? A minor, C, right? And the chorus, C, G, F, or whatever, but they're all inversions. So the G is over B and the F is over A. So like—
and even in the verse, right? It goes from that A to the low C.
Yeah.
And that makes it feel like a new chord, even though it's just two chords.
Yeah, right. And the way that he's playing it is thoughtful. Like, there's melodies inside of those chords that he's bringing out.
And I agree, it sounds simple, but then when you listen closely, there's so many interesting things.
The kick part.
The kick comes ba-boom. Ba-boom, right at the right moment. It's the clicks, too, giving you a little bit of a backbeat, not too much, it's not overwhelming.
But normally, for a song like this, You might hear like some Mumford and Sons shit where it's just boop, boop,
yeah,
boop, right? That would be like a down the middle normal approach, but he goes boop, boop, boop,
yeah,
right,
or whatever it is.
And sometimes it's not a double hit. Sometimes it's just one hit. It sounds very sporadic. It sounds very organic. It sounds The other thing I think that really stands out for me is a lot of great songs. The vocals take on a new character in the chorus. The chorus hits and you're like, oh, I didn't know that their voice would sound like that.
I told you to be patient and I told you to...
So, like, he's literally like screaming.
Also, versus falsetto, chorus is pleading chest
voice. Is high chest voice. Kind of the same notes, just with a different voice.
You know? One of the things that struck me, I saw you guys play with you at the Greek in Berkeley.
Yes.
And it was one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life. One of the first things that struck me is how insane of a singer he is.
It's the best instrument I've ever been on stage with.
He, like, you don't get it because normally people double and triple themselves because they're not strong enough.
Right.
A singer to just, like, Elliott Smith was self-conscious about his vocals, so he doubled it, right? John Lennon, vocal doesn't sound good, just double it, triple it. And so you hear this in the recordings, don't get a sense of how insane a singer he is.
And yet there are a few tells, right? Which for me, again, it's like a, I think restraint is the word of the day here. But listen to this bridge section here. Right, yeah. You can tell the dude can fucking sing. Listen to this. Those runs are not easy runs.
Right.
And then you hear like the double, triple, however many vocals there are in there, they all do the run.
Yeah. Right.
Kind of independently on each other.
And not really locked in.
Not really locked in, but each one like so expressive on their own.
It's, right.
It's interesting.
It sounds like the guitar is suffering. I don't know how else to explain it. It's out of tune.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like it's being stretched beyond where it should be playing.
Right.
It almost sounds like it's a guitar that's like he left out at the beach for a day.
Right.
And the intonation is bad, and he didn't get set up properly. The action's too high.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, it sounds like a beach guitar.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. Like, I always think about, like, I've heard people say it. Like, I know, as a guitar player, I'm curious. Like, you pick up an instrument and it has a song inside of it. Mm. Sadly, my instruments like don't have any songs inside of them. You have to take 10 years to learn to play a song on them. But like,
there's things that guitars feel like they want to do that you can pull out of them. It's like, because
this sounds like one of those songs, right? Like,
yes, guitars are such an imperfect instrument. You know what I mean? Like, it's just not going to play into. And even if it played perfectly in tune, it wouldn't sound like a guitar. To me, it plays into what he's talking about in terms of like the guitar sounds like the vocal. You know what I mean? It's yearning.
It's raw.
It's raw.
Yeah.
The whole, everything's raw.
The other thing I'm so struck by, and I think about this all the time, is like, what's the point of music, right? What's the point of performing music? It's like, what's my emotion here to you, the pair of ears out there, as quickly and efficiently as possible,
right?
Like, whether or not Paul Simon does it with poetry, with words that get from his brain into you.
Yep.
And resonate with different parts of you. Justin does that with one note on his voice. Same way like Louis Armstrong did, right? Play, what? And you'd be like, I feel joyous, but like also tortured, and you get a complex emotion.
Yes.
One sound, and that's what this song does.
I love the way that he writes lyrics.
The lyrics are awesome.
Ambiguous and imagery and weird words.
But it's again the thing, like it's not, his thing isn't poetry, it's not about like here are my words, that's what I want to resonate. It's like, it's the sound of my voice and the emotion in my voice, so what words like make that, like don't get in the way of that, right? Like,
okay, that is, I think you nailed it. Like, he knows what his strengths are, and he's leaning on those.
Right. No, he writes great lyrics, and this concept of skinny love, that's not something I've heard of before. It's not something, but like, so you know what he means, you know?
Yeah.
But like, now I'm gonna like emote and tell you how that feels. It's fascinating.
Yeah. Also, dynamics.
Yeah.
There's so much. It's a guy and a guitar.
Dynamic range is just a fancy way of saying quiet, quiet parts and loud, loud parts. If something has a lot of dynamic range, it means there's really quiet, quiet parts and really loud, loud parts. I know this isn't an emotion, but it's something that I feel when I listen to this song. The feeling is redemption. Mm. Do you know what I mean? Like when you hear him, listen to this.
Joyous.
Like,
super joyful.
He's just you know, I just see a dude alone in his bedroom, just like jumping around and singing and just like the lovely major chord, you know, at the end.
Totally.
It feels like redemption.
I feel like a big part of what attracted people to this record was the story. Like whether, you know, it became a myth. It became like, dude, this guy was just like, he was like a quit all his bands and he was like, didn't know what he was doing. He moved to the cabin in the woods and like, and I can imagine, I mean, if there was this sort of like retreat from defeat into solitude and then you record this, like that must have felt amazing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
should we listen to the second song?
Yes.
Let's listen to Perth.
So interesting thing to listen to this is after the, you know, mythological cabin in the woods, you know, not many microphones, blah, 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 right? And this is the next sound you heard, right? Like
right.
after that record.
Is this the first song on?
The first song on the second record.
And
right?
you're on this.
Yeah, so I played on this.
Let's listen to it. Tim, you want to tell us a little bit about Perth before we jump in?
Sure. This is the first track on his 2011 self-titled album. Bon Iver won the Grammy Award for Best Alternative Music Album at the 2012 ceremony with this album, along with Best New Artist. Perth in the album represents beginning slash birth, while the final song on the album, Beth slash Rest, represents ending death.
Here we go.
Sick.
Perth, Bon Iver.
So you have your preconception of what the band is, right?
Yeah.
This folky thing,
yeah.
And then that happens, right?
Yeah.
The first minute of the song, he doesn't sing. In the last 2 minutes of the song, he
starts
doesn't sing.
Starts with electric guitar.
Starts with electric guitar. There's a violin harmonic solo, right? Like just the harmonics on a violin that Rob Moose plays, right? And then there's like an anthemic French horn lead at the end.
Like two drums?
I think three. I think he also played drums.
Oh, my God.
Military drums. Like, nobody's expecting that. When you do a song, there's no form to the song. What's the form of the song?
Right.
No, you know, like...
You use the word military. I'm going to latch onto that for a second. This feels like battle to me.
Yeah.
It feels like war. First of all, the feeling is victory. The feeling is triumph.
Right.
There's a navy, and there's a pier. Listen to the navy. Feels like Oceanside. There's like, this is like after the battle is over, right? This is the end of the song.
Yeah.
And then there's, listen to these machine guns. Right, there's machine guns.
Yeah.
And then there's fucking like, they're leading the troops to battle.
Right.
Before the war happens.
Yeah.
Like this whole thing feels like this war story where there's this, again, a feeling of redemption and triumph and like victory at the end. I don't know. That's probably a little English classy to kind of draw war themes here, but it definitely, it has that kind of violent military feel to it. I remember literally sitting in the car listening to this for the first time. I was so excited. I bought the record. I was so pumped about this record. The first thing that I couldn't get over was how dark the mixes.
Yeah.
All the highs have been rolled off the mix, even the cymbals. There's no shimmer, there's no sheen, there's like, it sounds like they put a shelf on everything above like 7K. It feels so dark to me.
Yeah, it sounds like he didn't use a lot of mics. Like he didn't use very many mics. It sounds to me like a lot of like RE20s and like SM7s, not a lot of like large diaphragm condensers and stuff like that. And then it sounds like tape to me. You said that he like bought a house in like upstate, and this was, he converted the pool into like a recording studio?
Yeah. There was a pool. It was an indoor pool, and he put covered it with a basketball court.
And that was the studio.
And that was the studio, yeah. And it sounds great. It's a beautiful studio.
So all of this was recorded in that pool.
Yeah.
With a thing on top of it. There was no like soundproofing or anything? Was there like Owens Corning on the walls or something?
Yeah, there was some treatment around.
There was some treatment, okay.
But it was,
and the control room was separate or inside?
Control room was separate because you don't have like a indoor pool. There's like a changing area. You can look out into the pool. So that's the control room. And we went to see the house and he was like, there's a window, like it looks like a studio. The other thing that's interesting to me also is like, there's like that French horn thing, like, that's not super soft, but you're sitting right there. It's not super loud, right? Yeah. I mean, I hope it's not super loud.
No.
That's like so huge over like tons of drums, tons of guitars, like the machine gun thing. And so it's just like kind of more mellow sound, orchestral sound.
Can I hear it?
Riding above it. And like in the same thing for like Rob Moose's harmonics.
Those
violin harmonics, like the softest thing you've ever heard. But they're so huge in that mix.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like speaking to what you're saying, because these are not sounds with lots of highs in them, right? They're not sounds that would normally just naturally cut through.
Can you play that for us?
Oh boy.
Pressure's on.
Yeah, pressure's on. Like. And for me, like technically, so like I had been, I'm a trumpet player first, and I had started playing French horn 2 or 3 years before this. And those are like high orchestral, like big notes. And I remember like, I had like, I could record those notes, but I couldn't like stand in front of 20,000 people and play those notes, right? And I was like, oh man, I'm gonna have to play that. Like, I can't get out of playing that because it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of one of the reasons I'm there. I'm gonna have to get a new horn. So I like went to Germany and bought a really nice horn for this gig. Cause there was no way I was gonna be able to accomplish it.
CJ, this song is so epic and so huge and such an anthem. It's such a victory lap. What is it like playing this music live at a festival or at a show with 10,000 people in the audience?
And also, how do you play two horn parts at once live?
Well, be a trombone player in the band, play the lower part. Nice. Horrifying. Really, really scary every single time. Because French horn is like, French horn is my, I'm more of a trumpet player than a French horn player, but and this was early in my French horn playing days. And it was the first song we would play in every single show. So you have nervous energy and you walk out, and I know the first thing I'm gonna play is the super anthemic thing from the new record that's getting all of this buzz and is why we're playing, right before Radiohead at Coachella, and why we're playing in an arena when the last time they were in the town was a small little theater, right? Like, and this is literally super duper hard for me to do.
So did you fuck up playing it live sometimes?
Yeah, every once in a while. But like, it was just like, so like, it was never autopilot. Never. If I did it today, it wouldn't be autopilot.
What's so hard about it?
Range. It's like really high.
What do you have to do like with your embouchure or whatever to play that high?
Really, really tight embouchure. And like with the French horn, the reason people say like the joke about the French horn is it's called the French horn, right? and that's because like with no vowels down, you can play. Right, all these notes that are super duper close together, right? So to play with that, like that's very stressful because there's like,
whoa.
Instead of hitting, you can go. So you're like really threading a needle, but like, it was, so to answer your question, it was always super scary.
I have anxiety right now hearing you talk
about
that.
But the funny thing is, you can't tell how hard it is by looking at you. It just looks like, you just guys just up there, you stick your hand in there and you're just blowing it and you just play the notes. Like,
right.
You're doing the hardest thing and nobody knows.
Nobody knows. They're just like, oh, okay, that's
so
hard.
So if you fuck up, people are like, what's wrong with you?
Yeah.
Push this down and blow into here.
Right.
Yeah. It's easy. Yeah.
So it was.
And meanwhile, you're performing open heart surgery.
Yeah, it's kind of,
in front of 10,000 people.
Yeah. It was a little musical open heart surgery.
Yeah.
All right. Tim, hit us with some trivia about Bon Iver.
Who is Perth inspired by? CJ, do you know this one?
The place?
No, it's a person.
It's a person.
A person.
No!
Sorry.
I don't know.
I thought it was a perfect joke.
Oh, okay. I gotta go.
Anybody got another one? Nope. It's inspired by Heath Ledger. The director, Matt Amato, was shooting at Justin Vernon's parents' house when he learned of the death of his best friend, Heath, who is from Perth.
Oh.
The lyrics were based on some of the stories that the grieving Amato would tell of Ledger growing up in Australia.
Wow.
That's heartbreaking.
All right, we got a question from a Scary Pockets patron here. With every Bon Iver album, Justin Vernon is able to create something so foreign that at first it's hard to even understand what you're listening to. And then over time, the soundworm works its way into your brain and the songs, the album, Once Alien, becomes so familiar, so poppy, so addictive. This is a feat rarely achieved. The only comparable artist is Radiohead. And Justin Vernon does it over and over and over again. What in the songs and albums enables this alien to best friend conversion?
First of all, he's like the most voracious, him and like the whole community of people he's around are the most like voracious listeners of music, right? Mm-hmm. They've listened to everything, pop, country, to like the Lounge Lizards. Deep cut jazz to Philip Glass and Steve Reich. So they can draw on anything. Any reference, any genre is like fair game to grab and bring into the fold. The way I ended up in the band was through playing contemporary classical music at a festival, and he saw us play these really thorny, you know, works by, you know, modern composers for chamber music sextet. And he was like, oh, I want some of that on my music, right? Mm-hmm. Not a lot of like pop people do that. The only other person who's ever done that are, only other people who've ever done that are Ben Folds and Paul Simon, right? So you have to have like open ears and constantly be looking for a new sound and a new way of presenting your voice and a new, you know, a new, yeah.
So great having you today, CJ.
Nice to be here.
Thank you for joining us. This was awesome.
Thank you guys for watching, for subscribing. Leave us comments about what you want us to respond to next. Thank you, CJ, for being here. Thank you, Jacko. We'll see you next week.